China is slowing down. Most of their wealth is in real estate, and yet their market rests upon a fragile foundation. There are only so many empty cities that can be built, only so many bridges to nowhere. This unsustainable path is failing. Today, we see a record level of stimulus injected into the markets, tax incentives, easy money from the banking system, and still slower growth than expected. This house of cards will collapse. You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. Today, we're going to have our focus specifically on China. There's a lot to get to. I want to talk about the real estate. I want to talk about the automotive sector. Underlying all of this, we have the issues that are going on between the United States and China. Understand that this trade deal is not going to be the solution to every problem that's been happening between these two countries. No. That's just one little small part of it. So remember that every time that this is brought up in the media, they believe that this is gonna be the peace deal. Everything is totally fine once this document is signed. Regardless of what happens with this agreement, there's a lot that these countries do not agree with, that they don't like about each other, and this is underlying all of that which is happening. There are currency wars that are taking place today, and of course, we must understand the power that China has because of the amount of treasuries that they still hold of the United States. So let's begin by taking a look at this. A fifth of China's homes are empty. That's 50 million apartments. You have to understand how serious this is. Despite the fact that the last time I brought this up, I was criticized because they took the population. I saw these comments, multiple people. They took the population of China, divided it by 50 million, and said that there's not a problem here. Why are you worrying about it? Other individuals were saying that it's very common for the Chinese to not buy homes that have already been lived in. Therefore, it's okay to have empty houses. No, we have to look at this much closer. It's obvious that having empty homes, sure, there's always going to be vacancies, is never a good thing. How can you ever suggest that a vacancy is going to somehow benefit the economy at all? It doesn't work like that. If the building, for example, an apartment building, has several vacancies, who's paying for that? Is there any owner of the unit at that point? Or is it owned by the corporation that owns this building? Who exactly is paying for all of that? You know, the way that these buildings are profitable is if they're full. They have to be full or near full in order to be profitable in most cases. If people aren't paying up, you got a problem. Or if it's an individual owning that, but nobody's renting it out or anything, or they're not living in it, well then obviously that's taking up money from people. They're spending it in the wrong place. It's not productive money. That's the point I want to make. The real estate is a house of cards. They're building empty cities. And of course, this is a problem that will be hitting them in the near future. It's already having an effect. There's only so many empty cities that you can build. Real estate as a percentage of household wealth. You can look at this in different ways, but let me try to get you inside my mind for a second here. If this was an investment and I was to say that I'm gonna buy different types of investments here, and there's real estate, there's paper assets, there's commodities, precious metals, there's businesses, all these different types. And so we look out there for the investments, we put our money here and there. Well, some people, they don't diversify, okay? They have only paper assets, for example. And there's other people who do only real estate, for example. Okay, that's not what this is. This is the average individual. We're not talking about investments. So most people, they keep their wealth in their own home. So this, to me, was interesting because you look at the United States numbers, 28%, and China is 75%. Well, I believe that part of the reason we're seeing this here is obviously people in China believe in real estate and they pay down their mortgages, or they don't have mortgages at all in some cases. In the United States, a lot of people are using debt. And I don't think that they are owners of those houses in so many cases. You probably have a lot of instances where in China, you're mostly an owner. Obviously, the big cities might be a different story. However, in the United States, there are many renters. I don't know the percentages here. I don't have them in front of me. I believe that that could be an issue. Also, people believe, whether it's the United States, Canada, UK, Australia, and so on, that their retirement account is the way that they will protect themselves. Whereas in other countries, they don't believe that, okay? They want to keep their wealth in the real estate. To me, that actually makes more sense. However, 401ks, supers are RRSPs and things like this are very common for people in places like the United States. And all I'm trying to mention is the fact that real estate is clearly extremely important for China. So this company right here, Evergrande Group, is one of the biggest, in fact, I believe it is the biggest builder in China. And they are going out there and giving 10% off all residential projects in the entire country. Across the board, 10% off. That to me is significant because it's not as if they're running a Black Friday sale. This is an actual response to the slowdown that is experienced right now in China. And we've only just begun. A frigid winter is coming to China's property market, and investors are wondering if the country's largest developer will be caught out in the cold. China Evergrande, which posted $45 billion in sales in the year to the end of June, but also carries the industry's largest debt pile, raised eyebrows this month with a $1.8 billion bond deal. This is what companies do. They go further and further and further in debt, but they expand further and further. And how are they not able to survive? Because the debt becomes too much. I don't know exactly what they're going to do in order to keep this company alive. Regardless, what we're looking at here is probably not the failure of this particular company. I don't know all the ins and outs. I just know that they have heavy debt. However, this is because of the slowdown, and companies fail when things slow down. It says it right here. They began phasing out a $1 trillion subsidy program for home buyers in smaller cities where Evergrande's projects are concentrated. So they were getting that incentive through the government, through the China Development Bank, and now that's not there. It's as if the Cash for Clunkers program, the TARP bailouts, similar situation going on. This is a chart that's associated with that. China's top 10 property developers. And you can see that Evergrande at the top there, their liabilities are the lighter blue line, and it is just excessive right now at this point. There's a few other names in this list if you want to check that out. China economy. Beijing unveils $300 billion of tax cuts to boost growth. In general, I think this is a great idea. I don't know exactly where this is all going to come from. I don't know how it's all going to play out. But in general, that's a good way to stimulate the economy. You're giving people the incentive. You're giving businesses the incentive to spend more. You're not just giving them a handout. You're actually doing it in this way is much better. Hopefully, that is actually a positive level of stimulus. Just take a look at China's slowing economy. This comes from the IMF, but we've seen these numbers everywhere. Their GDP has slowed down to rates at which, as far as I'm concerned, they haven't been at for decades. And this is with the covered up statistics. I wonder if they've been more manipulated over the years, or it's been the same throughout. Regardless, they are now at a level which the government themselves say that it's going to be between 6 and 6.5%. We've seen reports as low as under 2%. I've seen others saying between 3 and 4%. I don't know what to believe. Usually it's slower than what they're willing to admit. China's car slump has dealers slashing prices and giving cheap loans. Is it because the cars are too expensive? Maybe it's because they don't like the colors that they're making. No, it's because the economy is slowing down. People are not buying new vehicles. They're not going to change their houses. They're just going to stay where they are. A down payment of $149 is enough to drive home a new sedan. Now that is cheap, even for a country like China, where that converts to be a much larger sum. China's worst car market slump in a generation is forcing manufacturers and dealers to resort to generous discounts and loan offers to lure buyers as the slowdown hits automakers' profits. Incentives and reductions equivalent to more than 10% of the sticker price are now commonplace, and interest-free loan offers abound. We're talking about easy money going on right here in China, directly from the banking system, and you're also seeing that with real estate and with the automotive sector. Look at this. Interest-free loans, 10% off. They're able to walk away for $149. I mean, this is really, really cheap at this point compared to where it was. And at the same time, this is a country that consumes more everything than everybody, basically. That's what's happening. And if you see that slowdown, it will be pronounced and will be very rapid. Car crunch. China passenger vehicle sales fell by the most since 2012 as economy and the trade woes mount. Take a look at what has happened on the right-hand side. You could see all those in the red, and it seems to be getting worse, actually, if you look at it very carefully. The year-on-year change, there was only a blip in 2012, as you can see. What we're seeing today is persistent, and it's the trade issues, perhaps, yes, but there is an economic factor, which these type of news articles and things, they don't know how to do that. They're not going to be getting in depth. What we do here at the Money GPS is some depth, and that's why we can really focus on the issues at hand. Just take this for example. China's shrinking workforce. China's labor force fell to 897 million workers in 2018, falling by 0.5% in the seventh straight year of decline. Now, you have to understand the trend. It's not about the 0.5%, though I actually do believe that that is significant. It is the trend. And in this case, the trend isn't their friend. From 2011 to 2018, China's working age population, people between the ages of 16 and 59, shrank 2.8%. The working age population accounted for 64% of China's roughly 1.4 billion people. Here you can see the chart. Looking at this data, it is very worrisome because you have rising expenses. You have all of these activities that are moving into the cities. You have more people that need more things. Things are not getting any cheaper, and that's all financed by people's taxes, by their consumption, and of course, in certain countries where there's pensions, where there's investments, and so on, these Ponzi schemes need to keep money coming in or else they can't get the money out. And what happens? You have a slowdown, then you have a crisis, then you have a government that needs to have stimulus measures on all sides. This is a very controlled market despite what has happened over the years, how they've been opening up. It's still very, very controlled, and I would say more so than what we're told. Regardless, population problems are something they cannot fix. They did this to themselves. Unfortunately, we will see the effects of that. This is just another chart to give you some more detail based on this data about their aging population. I'm going to end the video there. If you found it informative, please give me a thumbs up. When you give me a thumbs up, you're supporting this channel. Just hit the one button to support me. I really do thank you for that. If you want the financial education you weren't taught in school, these two books have everything that you need. You can get all the details at the link in the description. If you want the audiobook, that's available at themoneygps.com. If you want to know what's happening with Venezuela and their connection with China, with Russia, and everything that's been happening today, you have to watch this video. Click on it, and I will see you there.